welcome to Play That Rock and Roll, where we take a look back at the albums and artists of the classic rock era.
Previous episodes of this show have detailed artists from this era, or have been countdowns on certain themes. But today, we're going to listen to an album. In fact, we'll be kicking off a new mini-series that will explore albums that all share a common theme, which is being generally considered as bad. Just about every artist at some point or another has released something that was not up to par. Whether it was because of low sales, high pressure, excessive drug use, or a case of simply phoning it in, most artists have something in their catalog they're not proud of.
Hey, nobody's perfect. So in this series, we're going to take a look at some of those albums and explore what, if anything, really went wrong. Now to start it up here, we're going to listen to an album from one of the world's most iconic bands, the Rolling Stones. Here's 1986's Dirty Work. Hit it.
Before we get to the album, we will need some context first. What happened with the Stones before Dirty Work? Well, basically everything. The Rolling Stones burst onto the scene in the early 1960s, and alongside the Beatles and the Kinks, they led the British invasion of bluesy rock and roll. In 1965, they topped the charts with perhaps the quintessential classic rock song, Satisfaction. They were not without their slip-ups, however, as shortly after, they released their Satanic Majesty's Request, which was a flop, and another potential episode for this show. Now, the four albums they released in the late 60s and early 70s cemented the Stones as one of the greatest bands of all time, but the following three showed that the rampant drug abuse and intense pressures of success were taking their toll. 1978's Some Girls is often considered as the last great Stones album released in their prime. 1980's Emotional Rescue was a shallow attempt to mimic that success, and 1981's Tattoo You was just a hodgepodge of songs cast off from earlier recording sessions. But it did give them their last big hit from their classic era. They followed that up with perhaps their strangest release to date, with 1983's Undercover, which stalled primarily due to a lack of a hit single and because the business-savvy Mick Jagger refused to tour to promote it, fearing overexposure.
Did you ever see the Texas Chainsaw Massacre? Horrible, wasn't it?
Okay, I know that's a lot of history, but there's still a little bit more. See, Mick Jagger and guitarist Keith Richards hadn't been getting along since about 1980.
Jagger had been prepping a solo career for years, and Richards saw this as the ultimate betrayal. In 1985, Jagger released She's the Boss, which didn't do very well. But he did keep his public profile up by duetting with David Bowie, Michael Jackson, and then with Tina Turner at Live Aid. Richards and Stones guitarist Ronnie Wood attempted to steal Jagger's thunder at the same show by backing up Bob Dylan. But while Jagger looked like he was at the top of his game, they came off as rather stale, as they stood rigidly behind a man who has always looked ancient.
Relax, don't do it when you wanna come.
But what about Frankie Goes to Hollywood then?
I think it's garbage.
Huh?
Total garbage.
Reluctantly, Jagger joined the rest of the Stones to begin the, dirty work, but it was apparent that he and Richards were not ready to make amends. Only three songs were attributed to just Jagger and Richards, while Ronnie Wood got an unprecedented four co-writing credits. Furthermore, the first single from the album was a cover, which was something they hadn't done since the early days. Despite the silly music video, I think this succeeds in being both a modern yet faithful adaptation of that old Bob and Earl song.
Speaking of that song, do you recognize this? Yeah, that's where House of Pain got it.
The album's only other single, One Hit to the Body, is another decent song with a ridiculous music video, featuring Mick with probably his worst haircut ever. Jagger Richards fight in this video was an all-too-real metaphor of how these two were getting along. Other songs on the album, like Fight and Had It With You, also speak to that conflict, as Jagger was looking to ditch the Stones, and Richards resented Jagger promoting the now-floundering She's the Boss. Although he did take advantage of Jagger's disinterest by singing lead on two songs, Sleep Tonight and a reggae number called Too Rude.
So how is the album? Well, in short, the songs range from pretty good to, meh, forgettable.
There's nothing atrocious on this album, but nothing that really stands out either. Well, except for One Hit to the Body, which I think is one of their best songs of the decade.
Granted, the 80s wasn't a great decade for the Stones, but still, that ain't saying nothing.
Songs like Back to Zero, Too Rude, and Sleep Tonight are pretty easygoing, very laid back, while Fight and the title track are harder and faster. Two songs, Hold Back and Had It With You, are probably the weakest of the album. And then there's Winning Ugly.
Rough. Probably the closest thing to a guilty pleasure on this album. Gosh, what was it with the 80s and winning?
Critically, the album was panned, but it did go to number 4 on the charts. Although that was a disappointment for the Stones, it was significantly more successful than She's the Boss or anything else in Jagger's awful solo career. Perhaps it would have enjoyed more success if they had toured to support it like Richards had wanted. But Jagger refused, citing a number of reasons, including drummer Charlie Watts' heroin addiction.
You want to go on tour, and Mick doesn't want to go on tour, and that's the cause of tension. Is that the case?
Yeah, but I mean, you don't do a gig like this without having fights occasionally. This one just happens to pop out into public, you know. Yeah, I thought the Stones should go on the road this year. But as I say, I'm a selfish guy. That's what I really like to do. So
don't let that clip fool you. At one point, Richards told the press he would slit Jagger's throat if he toured without the Stones. This kicked off a very public breakup of the band, as Richards and Jagger sniped at each other in the tabloids. The break allowed them all to work on various solo projects, but none from any party enjoyed any mainstream success. Eventually, they all reconciled in 1989 to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and to record an album.
A really good album!
...1989's Steel Wheels put the Stones back on top of the world and kicked off the period of twice-a-decade mega-tours, setting attendance records seemingly every time they went out on the road. And in 2013, the Rolling Stones celebrated their 50th anniversary as a band. So where does Dirty Work fall into their legacy?
I feel it marks and symbolizes an important point in the band's career.
It is an angry record born out of extreme conflict, as it was recorded at a time when egos were more important than the music. It should come as no surprise that the band doesn't look back too fondly on it. Although they have occasionally played the singles in concert, and Keith Richards has played Too Rude with his band. Ultimately, I think it's an interesting album and worth checking out if you're a Stones fan, but not as a starting point, considering how much other great music they have in their catalog.
At the end of the day, the album's title says it all, as this music, in many ways, is dirty work. But I guess somebody had to do it.
You fell out of a clear roof.
Television's boring you. Let's make sure they ain't so much there.
Okay, you can tell us when.
Okay.
Now. Yeah.